My favorite lore videos to do are the ones that few people know about, so today we're going to discuss a Lizardmen character and army choice I don't think I've seen anyone else recommend, including how to slot it effortlessly into Game 3. So kick back, grab a nice big old glass of milk, and let's get right into it.
Wow.
So, tons of folks are eager to see Oxyotl, and I definitely count myself amongst them. Lizardmen are actually my favorite Game 2 core faction. I mean, hell, in real life, I have a real-life Lizardman.
Hey, Gordito. Say hello to the camera. Say hi to the fans. Gordito.
Now, Oxyotl is amazing, and he makes perfect sense in a Game 3 Lord pack, but he's not the one we're here to discuss today. Nor are we going to discuss the adorable and interesting Tetto'Eko, nor Itsy Bitsy, who would also make sense in Game 3. Man, there's a lot of cool Lizardmen left. Maybe we should do a video on them later on. Let me know down below if you want me to do a Lizardmen Legendary Lord video, or maybe I'm just alone on that one. Anyways, back on topic. As interesting as all those characters are, they're not who we're here to discuss. No, today's character is incredibly niche and almost completely unheard of. In spite of that, I actually think they make perfect sense in a Game 3 Lord pack, far better than almost everyone else except for Oxyotl. They even have appropriate units, locations, and even an interesting rivalry option. Are you excited? Okay, I've teased you long enough. Our topic today is Lord Uhla'up. So, I'm assuming most of you don't recognize that name, so I'll give you a bit of background on him. Lord Uhla'up, the Voyager of the Raindrops of the Voyager in the Raindrops of Eternity, which is a name that I'm sure Setra really wishes he'd coined first, was always a bit odd for a slan. His peers, in fact, considered him to be straight up insane. He was immensely powerful, even by Slan standards, and he was unique in his desire to spread knowledge of the Old Ones. Whereas most Slan only concerned themselves in the Old Ones' directives, Lord Uhla'up believed that the other races of the world needed to know of the Old Ones in order to serve the Great Plan. He believed, rightly so, that the world was corrupt both physically and spiritually. Okay, makes sense so far. But he also believed that if he were to ever touch the ground, he too would become corrupted, and so he was always on his palanquin, hovering above the ground at all times. His palanquin was eventually damaged in battle, which would have been a concern for him were it not for the fact his temple car just decided, eh, no biggie, and hoisted the fat frog up and onto their shoulders after making a platform for him out of simple branches. Yes, he is essentially mounted to the Lizardmen equivalent of an oathstone. Rather than come back home to Lustria for a rest, or maybe just a second palanquin, Lord Uhla'up decided to just keep on trucking and eventually traveled so far beyond Lustria that the other mage priests could no longer communicate with him telepathically. As a result, they actually lost track of where he could even be, or frankly, if he's even still alive. Some held out hope that he was still alive and well and would one day come back having spread the word of the Old Ones completely to all four corners of the world, though most of the Slan assumed otherwise. We never got the answer in the Old World because, you know, it, you know, ended. Unlike every other Lizardmen Legendary Lord, Uhla'up would be a 100% dedicated caster lord. Unlike Mazda Mundi and Tehinawan, who can both ride big dinosaurs, Lord Uhla'up is just a big fat dude suspended by temple guards. He would have access to the lore of heavens, as to me, Voyager and the Raindrops of Eternity implies lores of heaven, and he would also have an ability to temporarily become unable to move, but would temporarily spawn a squad of temple guards, with the implication being that they simply put him down to go fight for him. In the lore, he doesn't actually have any unique items, but CA could make their own or reuse some of the other ones. I'm personally partial towards giving him a toadstone, which read the lore on that if you're curious, it's hilarious and weird, which would boost his physical resistance, the Staff of the Lost Sun, which would give him a ranged attack and anti-large, and the Totem of Prophecy, which would allow him to lower the leadership of all units in an area. Okay, so that's his pass, but how do we get him in the game? Well, we're going to hit this first because it'll affect everything else that we do from this point forward. The in-game explanation would be that Lord Uhla'up decided to make his way over to the Far East, hence why he went beyond the reach of the Slan. While there, he ended up realizing that the biggest threat to the Old One's prophecy were growing, those being Chaos. He'd instead have headed down towards the Dragon Isles to recruit some lizards to his cause in order to push back against the looming threat, becoming the leader of the Great Lizards, which is the name of the Dragon Isles' inhabitants. His campaign would be a markedly different campaign to most. Instead of simply painting the map your color, his objective would actually be in wiping out not only his chaotic rival, but also in vassalizing certain factions, the implication being is that you've taught them the purpose of the Old Ones as well as their purpose in the Great Plan. There'd be a few minor factions of humans, dwarves, elves, and perhaps ogres if they're released by then, of which you'd need to vassalize four. This wouldn't be as easy as it sounds, however, as you'd have to meet those factions, prevent them from being wiped out in the first place, and then do favors or quests for them in order to unlock the option to vassalize them. Every time you do so, though, your chaotic rival would make a strong push to come and try and kill both that faction and you. Alright, that's our starting position and objective down, and I wanted to get those out of the way so we can move on to the units, because they're all from the Feral Islands that he would inhabit, the Dragon Isles. Although there are some super interesting missing units, such as the Quaddle, we are going to focus exclusively on things that would match his theme of Feral Lizardmen. We'll start out with a Lord choice, that being the Skink Oracle. This would essentially be a Lord version of the Skink Priest. But we already have Slan, why pick an Oracle? Well, simple, because an Oracle could be made to actually punt fools around in melee. They would have access to the same lores as the priests, which we need more of. Actually, I think I'm just going to do a Lizardmen update video soon. There's a lot of stuff I'd like to see updated. Anyways, back on track. They could be mounted onto a Cold One for additional speed, or eventually put onto a Troglodon, which would give them an impressive melee potential and even a short-range attack option. Picture salamanders, but with poison instead of fire. Moving over to units, Troglodytes would be our Tier 2 infantry option, being even more powerful than Saurus, but would have primal instincts and lower leadership, which would make it difficult to keep them on target. They would also have an okay melee attack, but they would be noticeably weaker in melee defense than Saurus, which would make them more of a damage dealer rather than a true fighter. Carnivorous Snappers would be equivalent to sort of Feral Cold Ones, but would exchange the Cold Ones' armor in exchange for more speed, which would essentially make them kind of act like a blend between an unmounted cavalry and a hound unit, and they would be available at Tier 2. Our next unit will be controversial, but I'll suggest putting it in the Fangadon. If you've never heard that name, it's because it was only briefly mentioned in one line of one piece of lore from a single End Times unit, that End Time unit being the Red Shields. Their shields, that unit, apparently came from a Fangadon, which was a large, heavily armored beast. Although we don't have much info to go on, literally just being a name from one snippet, with a name like a Fangadon and with the simple fact that it was heavily armored, I would suggest making a Tier 3 or 4 monster with regeneration when in melee, which would make it a really interesting unit among the Lizardmen roster, and also on top of that, see it could have a field day with its design. And continuing with one more controversial idea, I'd propose that we have another high tier unit that I'm sure some folks are going to disagree with, the Arcanodon. Realistically, this would be trying to fulfill the same niche as the Stegodon with the Engine of the Gods attachment, but I would propose that the Arcanodon could be made much more of a damage dealer in melee and faster moving than the Engine of the Gods Stegodon, but would also abandon the ranged attack of its peer and would also be much more expensive to field as well. Continuing on with less controversial options, we could add in the Great Worm, which would be a Tier 4 Wyvern or Dragon equivalent, although it would not have a breath attack of its own. This would help add into the aerial options of the Lizardmen and could be used to essentially bypass spear walls to get at soft target like artillery and archers in behind the enemy lines. Our last option would be one that I'm sure many of you have seen suggested, that being the Thunder Lizard. In practical terms, this would honestly not add much more to the game than what the Dread Saurian already does, but even still, campaign super units are awesome, and I personally have no problem with adding even more of them to the game. So, there you have it. That's my personal recommendation to get Lord Uhla'up into the game. Do you like the idea of it? Do you think it's a complete waste of a Lord pack? Do you think that there's potential there? Do you think there's a better use for the Dragon Isles down there? Let me know down in the comments. I always do enjoy chatting with you. As a reminder, I'm going to do my damnedest to get the GPU video uploaded this coming Tuesday, so stay tuned for that. And as always, I want to thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you all next time.